Joining me now in the studio, Rabbi Shmuley Boteach, best-selling author, columnist, relationship expert, radio TV personality, former advisor to Michael Jackson. I could go on and on and on. Welcome, Rabbi Boteach.
It's a pleasure to be here.
You have written a new book.
I have.
This is called Kosher Jesus.
Yes.
Now, I'm going to guess, assume, I really believe it's going to be a bestseller. But I'm
God
sure,
willing, from your mouth to God's ears.
You also wrote the book Kosher Sex.
I did.
But this is your latest.
Yeah.
It's just out. But it's also a controversial book, is it not?
Kosher Jesus controversial? That's just a regular title. First of all, before we get into Kosher Jesus, in the space of 10 seconds, I just want to add my voice to those who are utterly condemning the acts of religious bigotry and intolerance that have dominated the news here in Israel over the past week. This is disgusting, nauseating. It betrays core Jewish values. You are not religious when you have a dark soul, no matter how black your hat is. You have to have love, compassion, especially when it comes to non-abusive treatment of women. Now, getting into Kosher Jesus, Jesus is the most famous personality of all history. And we Jews have allowed him to be ripped away from us based on a Christian narrative. And now that we have a political alliance between evangelical Christians in the United States, who are the most stalwart supporters of Israel, even more than the American Jewish community, it's time for us to build a theological bridge as well. Now, we're not going to understand Jesus in the same way, evangelical Christians and Jews, but there is a Jewish narrative to Jesus' story, as he was a Jew, that has yet to be told. And what I've done in this book was look at the Gospels in the order of their essential writing. Mark is the earliest, Matthew, then Luke and John. And the story evolves. And the question is, why do so many of the details change? And what I posit is that as Jesus was a Jew, and he never wanted to abrogate Jewish law, he never sought to stop the fulfillment of the commandments, and certainly he wasn't put to death by the rabbis or by the religious authorities, his purpose was to rebel against the Romans for their paganism, their persecution. And after the Jewish revolt of 66, the story changes. He is de-Judaized, as it were, and he was Romanized. And we end up with John chapter 8, verse 8, where Jesus says, "You Jews are children of the devil," thereby making Jesus the source of world antisemitism. Now, you take a Jew and you stick a white hood over him and make him a part of the Klan, that's character assassination. And there is a general movement on the part of the world's Christians to rediscover the Jewishness of Jesus, because if you don't understand the Jewishness of Jesus, you can't understand his humanity either.
All right, what kind of reaction have you been getting, good and bad?
Everybody loves me. They've always loved me. I'm lovable, huggable. I have a nice, comfortable beard here.
Having said that.
Having said that, look, I the reviews thus far actually have been amazing, which has surprised me, because I feared that people would look at this theory and they'd say this is a revamping of Jesus' narrative. But Publishers Weekly gave it an outstanding review. Christians are going to have some problems with the book. Some Jews are going to have some problems with the book, because for them, Jesus is not kosher. He's utterly treif. I mean, he's the height of that which is not kosher. Some people won't even say his name. When I was a child, we used euphemisms to describe the founder of Christianity. But as I said, this is all based on a Christian narrative. Now think about this for a moment. We Jews today require influence. We need a seat at the table of intellectual ideas. We have to bring our universal values to Western civilization, which is crying out for guidance and direction. Shouldn't we be demonstrating that the very essentials of Christianity stem from Judaism? Shouldn't the world actually feel that it has a stake in the Jewish people's future, which will lead them to take a stronger stand in defending Israel? The Dalai Lama and Tibetan Buddhists are protected by the whole world because people look at them as a source of spirituality which rescues them from a suffocating Western selfishness. But really, the Jews have a biblical mandate to be a light unto the nations. I'm hoping that this book will be a major contribution to that literature. So if people have a problem with it, buy it anyway.
All right. Rabbi Shmuley Boteach. The book is called Kosher Jesus.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for being with me.
A very inspiring and influential rabbi we have there. And he'll be here next week in Melbourne. You can see him at Caulfield Shul, and we'll have clips of him interviewed on the SHTICK coming up. If you want to get involved with the controversy at SBS Radio about Yiddish and Hebrew radio, well, the consultation link is put up on the screen for you now. We're going out with Y-Love, who is also a very inspirational person. His story is coming up, and we'll see you next week on the SHTICK.
I wanted to be Jewish ever since I was 7 years old. I saw a commercial on TV that said, "Happy Passover from your friends on at Channel 2, and I went drawing six-pointed stars on everything in my mother's house. I make Jewish hip hop and trying to change the world at the same time. Give a cold show, rich and more shine. The cola show, rich on the ground, the stone shines. The water gonna flow, check the fire in the sky. Then the horn gonna go, then we all gonna fly. Unfortunately, the urban music market has been plagued for way too long with misogynistic images, violence, glorifying drug dealing, glorifying lives of crime, glorifying basically everything which causes a society to decline. What I do is I throw Jewish concepts, Jewish text, Jewish values, Jewish outlook on the world into, you know, hip hop and into urban music. Change is perpetual, the lamentable thing is to claim. I'm trying to make hip hop that accents, you know, positivity. Still telling you the schedule, the sermon in the vestibule,
brilliant with the lexical, awakening the vegetable. Basically, I just grab anything spiritual around me and just use everything as a farm for words. I throw Hebrew, I throw Aramaic, I throw Arabic into the flow, I throw Yiddish into the flow, basically any language that I know a word from, I spit from. All up in the end of shots, like Mara Ravashi, Chatsi the Ami, don't recognize it in Rashi, Dati, how I gotta keep it la'alasi, smarsi, kama, the karti, because of the artsy.
Not all of my music has explicit Jewish content, but everything's coming from a Jewish point of view. My Jewish education and all of that came as part and parcel of the conversion process. When I was 21, found a rabbi on convert.org/orthodox, moved to New York, and started a conversion process then. After converting, I learned in Or Sameach Yeshiva in Israel for a year, and then in Muncie, New York for 2 years, learned at the Mir for a little while. So I started rhyming when I was in Yeshiva in Or Sameach here in Jerusalem. Hip-hop was originally the way that me and my chavrusa would learn Gemara together. We would freestyle the Gemara back and forth. We give out the cases, I'll freestyle the case, he'll freestyle Rashi, I be Rashi, you be Tosfot. And we would use music as a way to learn. I keep it so Torani, holla back if you get me. I be learning more Rashi than the Machzor Vitri. Trying to keep it kahalacha, this is bigger than minig. They'd rather be wrong for a century than right for a minute. I'm moving too slow, so I'm up and by the... We went up 4 levels in Shiurim in the time that most people went up 1. And I still remember the sugyas that we learned 10 years ago almost. And, you know, hip-hop came out of that. When we started doing hip-hop in the Beit Midrash, not everybody, you know, took a liking to it. Some kids would be like, how could you bring such a non-Jewish style of music into a holy place? This is treif. If you're trying to combine Torah with hip-hop, it's shatnez. A couple years ago, this guy came out, the Committee for the Purity of Jewish Music. It was this guy in Bnei Barak, this rabbi, who Mordechai ben David himself called this guy a sick individual. He basically came out with his list of what makes music kosher and what makes music treif. He said, hip-hop music is disgusting and has no place in our community. That was my personal favorite line. Music can't use saxophones. It can't have disco-style beats in a 4-note measure. If the accent is on the first and the third beat, then it's treif, but somehow you can change that up to make it kosher. When you try to restrict an art form like that, you just go and make a mockery of everything that you're trying to achieve. No one wanted hechshers on their CDs. And even Chabad.org, the reporter for Chabad Online said, the first day that they come out with a kosher CD, I'll be the first one to eat it. Music can't be treif. The only thing that can be treif is the content in the music. There's no style of music which is automatically anti-Torah. Jewish music is music that's created by Jews to communicate Jewish concepts to a Jewish heart and a Jewish soul. If that music is hip-hop, dancehall, salsa, merengue, country, whatever, it's all about the content, and I hope that the religious world one day would wake up to it. Hold up. Somebody let me finish that the Yiddish diminished sinner while we spit in the Kiddush. Herzog up at the Kiddush till we sip on the livet. I put the fire in your spirit till we dip for a minute. This is a ticker now. Watch as we raising them. Reish pei ches going straight for the cranium. Manifesting radiance. Existence is infinite. Paradigm shift because the present is derelict. Bringing the Mashiach and we trying to merit it. But if we ain't with the denim, then we go with a chesed ad. I ain't got to try. My rhymes dividing up inside of you. Intellect infected, transmitted on the viral.
Use hip hop to elevate, not to tranquilize.